Hi, sir. Good afternoon. Today, me and Debarati are going to present a topic on compiler design. So, here we go. First, let us see that what a compiler is. So, a compiler basically translates the whole source program to the machine program all at once and displays the error at the bottom. Now, following that, what a compiler design is. Compiler design actually tells us the mechanism how a compiler works. That is, it includes lexical, syntax, and semantic analysis at the front end code generation and the optimization as the back end.
Now, some features of compiler design are: what is lexical analysis? What are tokens? What is a parser? What is LL and LR parser? What is left and right recursive grammar?
So beginning with the lexical analysis. Now, lexical analysis is the first part of the compiler. During this whole compilation process, lexical analysis is the first phase. What it does is it takes the source program and breaks it into smaller series of tokens after removing the white space and comments in the source program. Now, what are tokens?
Tokens, token is the smallest element or character of a computer language program that is meaningful to the compiler. And the parser has to recognize these as tokens, which are identifiers, keywords, literals, operators, punctuators, and other separators.
Now we will move on to see what a parser does after the lex after lexical analysis. It is the work of the semantic analysis. Now let's see. Now what a parser does is the parser takes the token given by the syntax analysis, and with the help of that existing grammar that we provide, it converts the entire thing into a corresponding parse tree so that the later stages of the compilation can read that. Now, parser is also known as the syntax analyzer. Now, the parser can be a bottom-up parser or a top-down parser, that is, as it is shown in this figure. Now, top-down parsing is also called the LL parser. Now, it can be further subdivided into LL1, recursive descent parser, and the bottom-up parser is also known as the LR parser, which can be further subdivided into LR0, SLR1, LLR1, CLR1. Now, moving on, we will just have a look at what is LL parser and LR parser.
Difference between LL parser and LR parser. So first, in LL parser, the L of LL is for left to right, and second L is for leftmost derivation. Whereas in case of LR parser, L of LR is for left to right, and R is for rightmost derivation. Then in LL, it follows the leftmost derivation. Whereas in case of LR, it follows reverse of rightmost derivation. In case of LL, using LL parser, parser tree is constructed in top-down manner, whereas in case of LR, parser tree is constructed in bottom-up manner. Now, in LR parser, it starts with the start symbol, that is S, whereas in case of LR parser, it ends with the start symbol, that is S. In case of LL parser, it may use backtracking or parsing table, whereas in case of LR parser, it uses non-recursive shift reduce method.
Yeah. Now moving on to this leftmost derivation and rightmost derivation, we will see that what is a left recursion grammar and right recursive grammar. Now, a left recursive grammar is said to be a production of a grammar where the leftmost variable of its RHS is exactly same as the variable in the LHS. So we have an example over here. In this production rule, we have S produces SA or null. We can see that the leftmost element of the RHS, that is S, is exactly equal to the LHS, that is also S. So it will create a left recursive grammar. Similarly, what a right recursive grammar is that the rightmost variable of the RHS is same as the variable of LHS. In the following example, we have S produces A. So over here, we can see that in the RHS, the leftmost in the RHS, the rightmost element is S, which is exactly equal to the LHS, which is also S. Now, these were the introductory part of this compiler design. Now, let's moving on to the following questions, which follow as.
So here are some gate questions asked in previous years. Starting from the first one, in a compiler, keywords of a language are recognized during, there are four options: A, parsing of the program, option B, the code generation, option C, the lexical analysis of the program, and option D, the data flow analysis. Now, the correct answer is option C, that is the lexical analysis of the program. And the explanation for this answer is, as we know that the main job of the lexical analyzer is to first read the source program by its each character, and then it returns the tokens of the source program. And tokens are nothing but identifiers, keywords, literals, constants, variables, and so on.
So yeah, now moving on to the next question, we have, which of the following derivations does a top-down parser use while parsing an input string? The input is assumed to be scanned in the left to right order. So we have the options: leftmost derivation traced out in reverse, rightmost derivation, and rightmost derivation traced out in reverse. Now the answer is leftmost derivation. Why? Let us look at the explanation. We all know that the introductory part, that a top-down parser uses the LL grammar. So obviously the explanation becomes self-explanatory, but yet let's move on with the explanation. That is, in a top-down parsing, we just start with the star symbol and compare the right side of the different productions against the first piece of input to see which of the productions that should be used. That is, there is the leftmost the definition that is said over here is exactly equal to the leftmost derivation. So a top-down parser is called an LL parser because it parses the input from the left to right. That is the first L of the LL means this, that it parses the input from left to right, and the second L means that it constructs the leftmost derivation of the sentence. So we have the third question over here.
So now in the third question, we are asked that the number of tokens in the following C statement is. So here we need to count the number of tokens. So first printf will be number one. Then opening bracket will be number two. After that, the entire statement within entire code written within the double quotes will be considered as a single token. So that will be number three. After that, comma will be number four. I will be 5, again comma will be 6, ampersand will be number 7, then ampersand will be number 7, and then closing
bracket. I
will be number 8, closing bracket will be number 9, and then semicolon will be 10. So the correct answer will be option C, number 10.
Yeah, we go on with the next question now. Consider a context-free grammar with SAB as the non-terminal alphabet, AB as the terminal alphabet, S as the starting symbol, and the following set of the production rules are given. These are the production rules which are given, and we are asked that for the string AABBAB, how many derivation trees are there? Options are 1, 2, 3, 4. Now let us look at the answer. The answer is 2, and here goes the explanation. According to the production rules that were given, we can clearly see that we can derive AABBAB from two sets of production. That is, in the first one, we can see that S produces AB, and from there, if we expand that B into again AB, then again we expand AB to BS, and likewise, we get AABBAB. In the second production rule, in the first term, we did exactly the same thing. As you can see in the brackets, there it is written till now, one choice is possible. But in the second choice, we are changing the production rule from BB to BS. Now, using the production rule, we are expanding the grammar, and we can find that we are again able to get the string that was provided, which is AABBAB. So in two ways, we can reach this string. So hence, there are two possible ways, and that is the answer. Moving on with the final question we have.
So the question number 5 says that which of the following grammars is free from left recursion, and we are given 4 options: A, B, C, and D. So the correct option here is option number B, and the explanation is, in option A we can see that there is left recursion because in first line A is producing AA B, so that is left recursion. In option B, there is no left recursion because none of the leftmost symbol of the right hand side is equal to the left hand side. In option C, there is left recursion. Again, in option D, there is again left recursion. So the only option left with no left recursion is option B.
And here finally, we conclude this presentation. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kostha. Thank you, Devaruti.
Thank you, sir.
Excellent presentation, but I'd like to speak the top-down parsing. You missed one. That is the brute force parsing technique. That's the leftmost. Then comes the recursive descent. The recursive descent doesn't allow the any left recursion. Okay, only. But that. But the, what is the difference between brute force? Brute force can take all parsing, but
all
it, but it get O n cube or O n to the power 4. N is a number of terminals, and it has a space complexity also. Lot of space it takes. And then comes the recursive descent. Recursive descent, the rules has to be modified that there will be no left recursion. Okay, right recursion can be no issue for the recursive descent. Yeah. But recursive descent can also backtrack. It can also backtrack. It doesn't avoid backtrack, and backtrack means the time complexity, space complexity more. The next best solution is the LL1 parsing. What is the LL1 parsing? No left recursion. No left recursion should be there. Then you have to calculate. Then you have to take the variables, and you have to calculate. You have to go for first calculation, first set, and follow set. And any variable goes to nullable. Then you have to say that variable is nullable. Then you have to take. Then you have to take first function of that variable nullable. Then you have to take follow of that function.
Follow of that function.
Of the variable. And first and follow should intersection should be shy. First of that variable and follow intersection should be shy. If a variable say A goes to alpha 1, A goes to alpha 2, A goes to alpha 3, there are the strings, then first of alpha 1, first of alpha 2, first of alpha 3, intersection should be shy. Okay, then if it is okay, so left hand side all variables you have to take first and follow, and if a variable goes to multiple string, A goes to alpha 1, A goes to alpha 2, then you have to take first alpha 1, first alpha 2, first alpha 3, then all first of all A for variable A, first of alpha 2 intersection should be high, and if variable A goes to nullable, that any variable which goes to nullable, you have to take first of that variable and follow up that variable should be shy, intersection should be shy. Then it can be guaranteed it is a LL1, and then you have to go for LL1 table. Then LL1 table, left hand side should be all variables, top should be your terminals. And everywhere you have to practice it. Then everywhere I'll cover in the class. And only one and only one rule can come into this. And this, whenever you are the precondition, necessary and sufficient condition, I have told you. Then if you find it is okay, then you go for LL1. And LL1 table, whenever it is there, then it is a guaranteed, unambiguous. It is guaranteed. It can be done ON. It can be recursive descent without backtracking. So what is the difference between recursive descent and LL1? You can tell that LL1 parsing is nothing but recursive descent without backtracking. Recursive descent can have backtracking, and recursive LL1 is recursive descent. Another name is recursive descent without backtracking.
Without backtracking.
Thank you very much. I am recording.
Thank you, sir.
Please be there. Please be there.